Gospel of John, we're in chapter 17. As I said, we're going to go through the whole chapter and we're going to break it down into a few parts. The main reason is because this is one of the most relevant chapters in the Bible to Calvary Chapel, Ontario. It is, as we are in it tonight, but also there's a checklist, another one of these checklists. Every so often we arrive at that point of a checklist. And what I mean by a checklist, just something that we can go through, certain concepts of what the Lord has in this particular case, not necessarily personally, but corporately. Things that we can look at that Christ was praying for, and that this is, we call the disciples' prayer, which is in Matthew chapter 6, we call that the Lord's Prayer. Well, in actuality, this is the Lord's Prayer. The one that we see in Matthew is the Lord teaching his disciples how to pray. Here we see the Lord praying. Again, it's just moments before his crucifixion. And we see in this prayer, peppered throughout, certain concepts that a church would do well to just kind of stop and to evaluate and to make the determination, are we doing these things? Do these things pertain to us? I mean, they'll pertain to you personally, but tonight I just want to look at them corporately. When you're evaluating your church, and the church should be evaluated, are we being found faithful in doing these things? Now, a church, by the world's definition, is just a gathering together of religious people for a common purpose, and that they've been given tax-exempt status. But by this definition, the only thing that sets us off from a sports team, a business, or a flash mob is our tax-exempt status. We know it's so much more than that. It's all about Jesus Christ and him crucified. I gave the devotions with the teachers before service, and we looked at Acts chapter 17, and the Apostle Paul, as he went into Athens, and he was just beside himself. He was told to go into Athens, and he was told to go into Athens and wait. The support group asked him to do that, but it says that Paul's heart was just perplexed as he saw all of these monuments that were dedicated to these various gods, and there were just millions of them. I don't know millions, but there was quite a few. And the city was wholly given over to those things. And really what you see is the futility of man's wisdom and man's philosophies, because the philosophers of the day, well, they kept building monuments because they had to keep manufacturing gods, because the philosophies attributed to those gods did absolutely nothing for mankind. And so Paul was in the marketplace and he was sharing of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they realized that this guy's got something new to say. And so they were all about new, because again, old didn't work. So they grasped onto him and brought him into the Areopagus, or Mars Hill, this place of examination. And Paul had an opportunity. He had an opportunity. He built the bridge, speaking of these gods. And as he saw this one dedication to this unknown God, he says, this is the God that I do know, and that you would be able to know as well. But he saw he was permeated in just human intellect and just the despair of it all, to such a degree, after he left Athens, he went to Corinth. And when he came into Corinth, he said, I did not come to you with excellence of speech. I came to you proclaiming nothing other than Jesus Christ and him crucified. And that's all we have to proclaim. We're not to be anything else. Yeah, if we can feed the poor, we feed the poor. We definitely take care of the family of God. There's so much more, yeah, that we can do. But unless we're preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, we're absolutely doing nothing. We're not achieving anything whatsoever. And so these are the things that we got to be dedicated to. And so really what we're going to be doing here is eavesdropping upon a conversation between the Father and his Son. And we're going to look at seven things that, when combined, set a example of what a church of Jesus Christ should be. What really sets us apart from any other gathering of God's people? Seven things that, even if one thing is missing, then this church or any other church, well, we have to question, are we really able to call ourselves God's church? In this, you'll need to come to your own conclusions as far as your own church, because I invite you to break open our own church. Evaluate this church. If there's somewhere that we're lacking, if there's somewhere that we're falling down, then it needs to be brought to the forefront, and it needs to be dealt with. Because the only way we're going to be an effective body of Christ is to be obedient to what God has called us to be, and to follow through in the things that God has laid before us. I'm going to read through this list. If you're taking notes, if you're a fast writer, you can write them down. But then obviously I'm going to go through and break them all down one at a time. So just bear with me. I want to thank you, too, for those people who prayed for me. If you were here Sunday, I could hardly talk. Had a rough day Monday, but then I seem to be getting better. So this list, verses 1 through 5. First one, is our church a church that glorifies God? Is a person being glorified here, or is God being glorified here? Secondly, in verses 6 through 12, is our church a church that is centered upon the Word of God? Because if your church is not centered upon the Word of God, then you'd have to ask yourself, what is it centered upon? And what good is that which it's centered upon going to be able to do for that church or anybody else? Verse 13, is our church joyful? Is there an element of joy that can be found in this body of Christ? Fourthly, in verses 4 through 17, is holiness and sanctification earmarks of our church? Are we teaching it? And does it even exist here? Fifthly, verses 8 through 19, is our church either missions or outreach minded? Have we pulled within ourselves? Are we a church that reaches outside of these walls? Verses 20 through 23, is there unity in our church? Is it just cliquish? Is it just a bunch of people who happen to show up on a Thursday night? Or is there a feeling of family as we gather here? Are we praying for one another? Are we ministering to one another? Are we caring for one another? And then verses 25 through 26, is love exhibited in our church? So first, verses 1 through 5. Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have glorified you on the earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. Now, keep in mind that, again, as I just said, it's just moments, hours before the cross. Christ in all of his glory is going to be lifted upon that cross, but we know he is going to eventually ascend into heaven and be back. All of those godly attributes that he set aside that we see in the book of Philippians, in Philippians chapter 2, those are going to come back to him, if you will. And he is going to be seated at the right hand of the Father. He's going to be seated on the throne of glory. And so again, we have to ask ourselves, is our church, and you can make this personal as your life, but is our church a church that glorifies God? You ever leave here and go to another church? It's a good list to have to check off to make sure that that church is of the Lord as well. Every organization of man glorifies either somebody or something. You look at Apple computers, you probably think of Steve Jobs. Microsoft, probably think of Bill Gates. A sports team or a movie, you probably think of the actors, you think of some sort of person. And even in churches, we can kind of do the same thing. You can mention a church and you're not really thinking of the Lord, you're thinking of the man. And the church, it's got to be pointing people to Jesus Christ, because Christ is who they need. The man standing behind the pulpit could do nothing for his salvation other than to believe in the gospel as it was presented to him at some point in his life. Prayerfully that happened. But he can't do anything for anybody else. I can't save one person. It's all about Jesus Christ and what Christ has done for all of mankind. This is why we've been kind of, this year, I just felt the Lord lay it upon my heart to have this leading up to Easter. Because so many times, you know, we have this big build-up as far as, you know, we're doing a decor, we're doing a play, we're, you know, having special worship, and we're practicing on all of those things, and it's on the calendar, and it's coming, and we're increasing our services and our chair capacity within the sanctuary. We're getting ready for this, and all of a sudden the day comes, it's done, it's over, we take Sunday night off, and then we're just back to what we used to be. But what impact is it going to have upon our lives this year? And so the Lord laid upon my heart, we did the Psalms of the Cross. We did those, and we saw Psalm 22, 23, and 24, and how they pointed to the cross, what was occurring upon the cross, and what was the results of the cross. We went on with our epistles, we were in Philemon, which is just one chapter, and we saw the doctrine of forgiveness. And then last week, we looked at the doctrine of justification and what it means to be justified in the sight of our God. And then this Sunday, we're going to be speaking of Palm Sunday, but we're going to be looking in detail of Jesus Christ, who he is. Who is that that came into that city on that particular day? And then on this year, on more than likely on Friday, on Good Friday, we're going to be looking at the Seder meal and how it's fulfilled in Christ. And then we're just going to get back to the gospel and just the basic elements of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And just to be reminded and understand that these are an integral part of what we believe, and what we believe is an integral part of who we are. And so you have to understand that these are the details that have made you who you are today and will continue to refine you into who God desires for you to be even in the future, regardless of age, regardless of who you are. And so in all things, Jesus Christ is our example. Look at verse 4. He says, I have glorified you on earth. Well, nobody has glorified God more than Christ did while Christ was here on earth. But I see, just as Christ did, so must I. That glorifying the Lord through this life that I live, through the things that I speak, and through the things that I do, not as a pastor, but as a Christian. I have glorified you on earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. What a blessing to be able to say that on the last day, that I have finished the work that you have given me to do. I mean, if today was your day, if the Lord called you home today, could you say, I have finished the work that you've given me to do? I know I can't say that right now. Some of it I've been unfaithful, and I need to, you know what, I need to pick up, and I need to continue to push on. I don't feel like I'm at the end just yet, but you never know. Maybe God's got other ideas, but I just want to continue to push forward to that higher calling in Christ Jesus, because he's always got a greater work, and it never ends. And so, really, when is the completion of the greater work? When you're standing before the Lord. Long to hear those words, well done. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 through 12, he says, Beloved, so he's speaking to the church, he's speaking to born-again believers, he says, I beg you, you know, Paul, and we'll look at Romans 12 later on, Paul says, I beseech you, and the idea is the same. You'd see the importance that an apostle lends to what he is about to say. And so if Peter was going to say, hey, I beg of you, or Paul, hey, I beseech you, I think that we should take notice of that. Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, as people who are temporarily here, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable amongst the Gentiles, in this particular case it would be unbelievers, that when they speak against you as evildoers, when they speak against you Christians as bad people, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Glorify God in the day of visitation. That's not the day of visitation when Christ comes back, when they have absolutely no choice. But the day of their visitation is the day that God has appointed for their salvation. And really, it's the day that God has appointed for them to hear the gospel, for them to come to make a decision. Remember, Paul said, because of the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Well, that would be on the day of their visitation. And his prayer is that we would not disqualify ourselves from being used in that person's life through a life that was lived carnally, but we would live a life holy, so that when we have that opportunity in somebody's life, that God's going to be glorified. And have you ever seen anybody who the spiritual light went on and you just saw that changed life? You saw that they got it. And you saw that this is something that is just hit so deep, and you just saw it was as if the glory of God filled that person. And that's what he's speaking of. I got to, you know, first of all, especially as a father, I got to make sure that I abstain from fleshly lust within my home, because each of my children are going to experience the day of their visitation, and I want them to glorify God. I don't want to be disqualified from being part of that salvation process, nor do I want to detract from that. And the same thing with my wife. I can't tell you how many spouses I've seen that just pretty much want nothing to do with that religion, you know, because he came home and he did this and did that, and we would go to church, and after a while, they just simply had enough. They consider them and all believers to be evildoers, if you will. And so us, that we would continue on in God, in the Lord Jesus Christ, to glorify his holy name. How does a church who desires to glorify God, how does it start? Well, what Jesus is doing right here is simply praying. Now, there's done so much. Read the rest of the gospel. But here at this point, when things are coming to an end, when he knows that he's going to be taken by evil hands, he prays. And he's praying, and it's his heart desire that he would glorify the Father in heaven, that the Father in heaven would be glorified through, and what is he praying for in essence, is his plan for salvation that was in existence from the foundation of the world. Just focus upon this. Next week we're having week of prayer and fasting. Just pray. If you don't know what else to pray for, which I can't imagine, you don't have a whole bunch of stuff to pray for, but make it part of your prayer that God would be glorified through your life. God would be glorified through your speech, and God would be glorified through your efforts. I guarantee you, if you focus upon that, that's a prayer that God's going to answer. People are going to take notice. And as people take notice, you just see what God's going to do. Just be people who pray. Just because the greatest example is, it's exactly what Christ is doing here. And so Jesus in verses 1 through 5, he's praying for himself. Then later on in verse 19, we're not going to go there right now, but Jesus prays for his disciples. And then in verses 20 through 26, Jesus prays for us. It's kind of an amazing prayer. He's praying for those who are going to hear the words of the apostles in the future. So as we read this prayer that he prayed some 2,000 years ago, he was praying for you even back then. And again, we think these things through. It's an amazing thing. I look at this as a parent. I prayed for myself as a parent when I got saved because I needed prayer. I prayed for my children. My children needed prayer. And now I pray for my children's children because my children's children need prayer. My kids, I prayed for their spouses. I prayed for their jobs. I prayed in detail over their lives. And I'm starting that, and I continue to pray for my kids, starting that with grandchildren as well. And so as Jesus has set this example, how should we not fall short? And those that we know, now Jesus is praying for those that you have given me, speaking to the Father. It's undeniable those whom God has given you. There's some people that maybe you can question, but as far as your spouses, as far as your children, and then applicable to me and a few others, grandchildren, there's no doubt. I have a responsibility. Matter of fact, far be it from me that I would sin and not pray. We have that responsibility. And this glorifies God. Because what greater glory can I give to God than to give God the future generations as well through my efforts in training them up and to praying for them? Verses 4 and 5, I have glorified you on earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you before the world was. God will glorify that church with his presence. In Exodus chapter 40, verse 34, Moses had finished building the tabernacle. He went through and he did it in detail. And God told him, everywhere that I told you to put the furniture, put the furniture. All of the hooks and all of the skins and just all of those details, all the tapestry that was upon the ceiling of the fine linen, that was the first layer that you would be able to see on the inside. Just all of those things, as it was done in detail, as he was obedient in doing these things, what happened? He glorified God, and God's glory came and dwelt with them. As he did what God had told him to do, then God blessed them with the knowledge of his presence. And it's the same thing that God will do with us. As we glorify the Lord is going to glorify us. And what I mean by glorifying, yeah, there's future ramifications in that, but also presence. See, people should leave a church that God glorifies knowing that they've spent time with him there. Or, again, when you've ministered to somebody and it's just been a blessing and you just knew that this was of God, whatever it is that God has called you to do, and you just left and you just realized that God was with you when you were ministering, and he's still with you even right now. The picture is in Moses. Moses went up, And when Moses was speaking to God and he was getting the commandments and getting the instruction for the people, he went down from the mountain and he was all shiny. He was reflecting the glory of God. And that's what we're to be doing. We're to be people who reflect the glory of God. What is it that God has called you to do? What has he gifted you to do? In the body of Christ, reflect the glory of God. Because as I exercise my spiritual gifting through the power of the Holy Spirit, it's not me, it's not my glory who's being seen, it's the glory of God. And so there's just so many ways that God is able to be glorified. I won't point out the person's name, but he's usually with me all week long. He had an idea about the chairs, and he had this way of laying them out and measuring them to make sure that they're all straight and everything, and you kind of think, well, what's the big deal? But I look at these chairs, and they're just meticulously straight and in line and all of that, and I look at it, and it fits my eye really well. And it's not going to make me a better teacher or anything, but it's just all those little details that just lend to, you know, glorifying God in this, and doing this is unto the Lord, and doing all these little things, and it all serves a purpose. And any little insignificant or thing that you may consider to be insignificant, well, that's not true, because nothing in the sight of God is insignificant. If God has enabled us to do anything, it's got reason and it's got purpose. So that which God has enabled you to do, that which God has called you to do, never discount it. Hold it dear to your heart and glorify God, because God's glory will be reflected from it. Verses 6 through 12. I have manifest your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you, for I have given to them the words which you have given me, and they have received them and have known surely that I came forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours, and all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to you. Holy Father, keep through your name those whom you have given me, that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me I have kept, and none of them is lost except the son of perdition, that the scriptures may be fulfilled. We know he's speaking of Judas, and he did not lose anybody because Judas was never really his. The scriptures spoke of that event that was going to occur. And so the next question is, secondly, is our church a church that is centered on the word? Now, just because I come up here and speak the word every Sunday does not mean that we're centered on the word. You can go in so many different directions. You can use the word as a jumping board into whatever it is that you want to jump into. But really, does the word permeate from this place? It's something that we have to ask. We must know, because if not, if a church is not centered upon the word, then ask the question once again, what is it centered on? If it's not centered upon the ideas of God, then it's going to be centered upon the ideas of man. And again, I can refer you back to Paul in Athens. It didn't do any good for them back then. It's not doing anything good for man even today. And so we must consider, where is it that we are to draw our understanding and our wisdom from? Man's wisdom even is being fulfilled even as we sit here. It was just a couple of hours ago that... And I agree with the idea or with the decision, but our country launched 50 to 60 missiles into Syria in retaliation for the gas attacks. But do you just see? You see the wisdom of men? Gas? Why do we even have gas? You know, poisonous gas. And missiles and all of these things. And you just see where the wisdom of man constantly leads to. Now, after what do they call World War One? World War One was the war to end all wars. What did we have 20 years after that? We had World War II. And after World War II, you would just think that man would be sick and tired of it, but it was some 5-6 years later that we had the Korean War. And then after the Korean War, it was 10 years later or so that we had the Vietnam War. And wars just never seemed to stop. And things are getting even worse, and it seems like we're even having wars on our own city streets anymore. This is where the wisdom of God brings us to every single time. things aren't getting better, things are getting a lot worse. And so a church that is not centered upon the Word of God, you would also have to ask, what is it that they're trying to achieve? Because the only way to achieve God's desire is through God's Word. Verse 6, I have manifest your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. Jesus, well, we saw at the beginning of this gospel, he's referred to as the Word. When he says, I have manifest your name, the Word has manifest the name of God. What is the name of God? It's the nature and the essence of who God is. God's name is best defined in the book of Exodus, chapter 34. We've looked at it before, but just fairly quickly. Moses wants to see God. In chapter 33, we're told that God passed before him. But the only thing that he saw was the hind parts of his glory. Again, best way for me to kind of picture that is a meteorite with that tail. And all he saw was the tail end of the glory, because that's all he would be able to comprehend. But in that, he wasn't really getting an accurate picture of God. Now, in verse 5 of chapter 34, it says, and this is the same situation that's going on here, it says, now the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with Moses there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. Do you want to know who God is? Well, the knowledge of who God is in his name. It says, and the Lord passed before him and proclaimed. So this is how you're able to see God, if you will. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. And notice Moses' responses in verse 8. So Moses made haste and bowed his head towards the earth and worshiped. Because in the definition of that name, Moses came to the realization, I've seen God. And when man comes into the presence of a holy God, man is upon his face, bowing down in a spirit of worship. And so he understood God through the name of God. But we're told something very important in the book of Psalms, in Psalm 138, in this concept, verses 1 and 2. It says, I will praise you with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises to you. I will worship toward your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. And so, Moses, I'm going to give you a glimpse. And he did. He showed him the glory. He didn't see God in the glory, but he saw God, the nature and the essence of God, in his name. But all through that time, what was he doing? He was proclaiming his name. So we don't know the name of God. We don't know the nature or the essence of God except by the Word of God. And it shows the centrality and the importance of the Word of God, because without the Word of God, you don't know God. You just flat out don't know him. You're not able to understand him or comprehend him. And I can prove that. How did you come to know God? You either read the Bible or somebody spoke the word of God to you. And so because of its importance, look how Jesus prays here. Again, verses 6 through 8. I have manifest or revealed your name to the, I have revealed your nature and essence to the men whom you have given me. Speaking of the 12. Minus Judas. Well, he did do that with Judas too. Judas didn't receive of it. Who you have given me out of the world, they were yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. To the best of their ability, they're keeping the word of God. Now, the Holy Spirit hasn't been sent, and there's a lot of misunderstanding, but we know, looking back, that yeah, they did do that. Verse 7, now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. They understand that Christ and his ministry is from the Father, verse 8, for I have given to them the words which you have given me, and they have received them. They have embraced them and have known surely that I came forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. Then look over at verse 20. He says, I do not pray for these alone. I'm not just praying for the apostles here, but also to those who will, speaking of the future, believe in me through their word. And so once again, everybody here somehow, some way, is related to an apostle, spiritually speaking. It's because they spoke the word to somebody, they spoke it to somebody else, and from faith to faith to faith, it landed at your doorstep, the doorstep of your heart. The prayer that Christ prayed has come to fruition, but what was it based upon? It was based upon the preaching, the speaking, the proclaiming of the Word of God. If the Word of God goes away, then Christ's prayer was not answered. And so we see the times that we live in, we see the attack that we come under, we see the attack that the Word comes under and the truthfulness of the Word comes under. I see that, well, from what I see here, Christ prayed and he even speaks of the future. It's bulletproof, but the only thing that's going to hinder it is going to be me not proclaiming it. It's going to be us that we don't share it, that we don't speak it. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, and they continued steadfastly, cutting that straight path, in the apostles' doctrine, which would be the word of God, in fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Look at verse 13. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my... I speak in the world that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. Verse 13, it's the third question that you need to answer. Is our church a joyful church? Is it a joyful place to be? All the years that I was involved in traditional religion, wasn't very joyful. Everybody was stern-faced. The priests looked like they bit a lemon and continued to suck on it. They just had that face, like there was this big burden, and religion was just like that. It was something you had to do, and God was mad, and you ought not to make him any madder, and you had to do these things to keep him satisfied. And again, it was anything but joyful. Again, joy is not happiness. Happiness is based upon circumstances. But joy is based upon a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and an understanding of what that means for today and what that means in our future. You can probably pull more things out of the Bible, but I've come up with four things that cause joy to be full in a believer's life. The first thing that causes joy to be full in a believer's life is obedience to Jesus Christ our Lord. John 15, verses 10 through 11, Jesus said, "If you keep my commandments, you will abide or live in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full." And so what I see here is if I keep his commandments, if I make the love of God a high priority in my life, and I make the love that I am to have for others a higher priority than the love that I have for myself, then I'll have a joyful Christian life. I'll find contentment in this life. If I'm not doing these things, well, if you're disobedient to what Christ has called you to do and who he has called you to be, you'll find anything but joy in your life. Secondly, if you want joy in your Christian life, if your church wants to be a joyful church, pray. Pray. Come before the Lord in prayer. John 16, 24, "Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full." So if you're living a life and you realize I have no joy in my Christian life, are you being obedient to Christ? Are you doing that which Christ has called you to do? You've got to consider that. Am I fulfilling the ministry that Christ has called me to fulfill? Or am I on cruise control? Or have I just kind of found some comfortable niche somewhere and just kind of using that as an excuse to say that I'm doing what God has called me to do, but there's an emptiness because I'm not really being obedient to what I know God's calling? And secondly, are you a person of prayer? And again, it's not just throw some quick thing out, but to truly stop and to truly seek the Lord out in prayer. We talk about reading the Word and then talking about bringing it up and meditating on the Word of God. And there's still that same dynamic in prayer. There's a quick prayer, but then there's the concentrated prayer. The prayer when I reassure myself or reconfirm with myself, I'm speaking to God. And to honestly come before him with my request, both for myself, for others, for the situations and circumstances of our lives. It's as I do these things, I find that I will have a joyful Christian life. Thirdly, what brings joy in a Christian's life? Sharing your faith. And some people will laugh That's anything but joyous. That scares me to death. Well, that's one of those things that although you will be scared to death, once you overcome it, you realize God was with me. God was with me. Because you realize, usually you're scared because your weaknesses, well, the things you are scared of will reveal your weaknesses, and you're concerned about not knowing what to say. What if you come up with so many other scenarios? But when you do share your faith, you see the Spirit moving in you and through you. And he says in 1 John chapter 1, verse 4, and these things we write to you, John is sharing his faith, that your joy may be full. And so as faith is shared, it brings joy. And then fourthly, fellowshipping with fellow believers. The people that I see that are the least joyous in Christianity are the people who have isolated themselves. People who have isolated themselves from Christian fellowship. People who don't go to church. People who call themselves Christians and do not go to church, it's just not a good thing. There's anything but joy in their lives. 2 John 12, having many things to write you, I did not wish to do with paper and ink, but I hope to come to you and speak face to face that our joy may be full. And so is a church without joy, is that really a church? Because if we really understand what Christ has done and what Christ is doing in a body of believers, there's going to be joy. When we see God use us, there's going to be joy. When you hear God speak to you, when you hear God convict you, maybe even convict you of a sin, you should have joy in that, that God cares and God's doing a work within your heart. When you see God move in the body, you should have joy because God's mindful of us and God's using us. Romans chapter 14:17, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Fourthly, verses 14 through 17, is sanctification and holiness earmarks of our church. 14, for I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. To be sanctified is to be set apart from the world. To be holy is to be godlike. So even as we had Peter, I beg you, Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, I beseech you. So Paul, what is it that's really upon your heart for born-again believers? Paul is in essence saying here, if I could talk to the church throughout the ages, I would beg them as well. I would beseech them, therefore, brethren. So he's talking to believers. He says, by the mercies of God, this isn't even according to your own power, but it must be done by your obedience, that you present your bodies as living sacrifices. The problem in the church, there's plenty of dead sacrifices. But it's the living ones that God honors. It's those people who are proactive in moving forward in their faith once again. You present your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God. This is based upon the word of God. He says, it's your reasonable service. This is the least that we can do in God's church. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. To be conformed, it speaks of being pushed into a mold from the outside. What are we to be? What's to happen with us is to be transformed. That speaks of a change that occurs from the inside. And we know that. That's the word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. And do not be conformed to this world, but transformed. How? Through the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and perfect will of God. Speaks of sanctification, again, set apart from the world. And it speaks of holiness, to be more like God. Fifthly, is your church mission or outreach minded? Jesus is very explicit about a church that is not of the mindset to reach out, to know that there's people out there who are perishing, and to have truly a heart to do so. This is something that I see that we need to be constantly stirring up, because we can so easily settle into the pews within a church. It's that which we need to stir up, so we're of the mindset of going out. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 16, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. Are we good for nothing in the kingdom of heaven?
the way that I see here, what it says is that I've got to be out there. I've got to be out in the highways and the byways of life, and I've got to be that witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. And far be it from us that we would lose our flavor. Far be it from us that we would lose our seasoning. That, who's that one cook that used to go pow, pow? We would be like that. We would be that seasoning, that spice that is out there, that we would be out there stirring things up. There's only two reasons that we do anything here as a church. First, it's so that people would come into a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Secondly, it's so that those who know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior will grow in the knowledge of who he is. Those are the only reasons that we exist. There's no other reason. The reason this is called the Christian church, or you are called the Christian, is so that people will see Christ through you. We are to say it, and we are to display it. Sixthly, verses 20 through 23, is your church unified? Is there unity within your church? Verse 20, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you gave me, I have given to them, that they may be one, just as we are one. So Christ is showing the ultimate unity between the Father and the Son. How about us? We get along. We get along. Do you enjoy coming to, and I'm saying not just to sit in church because you're supposed to be in church or the teachings or anything like, but just enjoying being in the company of one another. Again, one of the hardest things to see is somebody who, especially somebody who comes here a lot, and they get up, you know, again, when I finish, I walk down the aisle and we kind of run into each other right at the point over there at the door. And they're, you know, I can watch them, and I can watch them just go walking out the front door and leave. And there's some people who come week after week after week and do that. And I wonder, who are they? Who are these people? Or sometimes I'll see a name and I'll see, there's one name that I can think of. I've seen this name for a couple of years and I still don't know who that person is. And we're not that big of a church. And I'm just saying, where is this person at? How come I don't know? And I've asked a few people here and there, not that many. But who is this person? And where are they at? And what's going on in their lives? And how come they don't plug in? How come they don't plug in so that they're well known? And so we have to understand the value of unity within the body of Christ, because there's so many people out there have been rejected by the world, and they for sure should be accepted by Christ. But also, as I build up the body of Christ in unity, just simply as a member of the church, then also they're there building me up. And as I'm pouring myself into a unified church, there's going to be times in my Christian life that I'm able to benefit of that as well. Paul said in Ephesians 4:29 through 32, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification or building up, that it may impart grace to the hearers. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed by the day of redemption. So what does that tell me? I can grieve the Holy Spirit. How do I grieve the Holy Spirit? By causing disunity in the body of Christ. You see the importance that God lends towards this. Verse 31, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ forgave you. And anytime I read this, I always say the same thing, so I might as well say it again. How did God in Christ forgive you? He did so in grace, while you were still a sinner, while you didn't deserve it. So you are to be forgiving just as God in Christ forgave you. That means I am to be gracious in the relationships that I have in the body of Christ. It's not waiting for somebody to be perfect, somebody to come up to our standards or anything like that. It's being gracious regardless of who they are or what they've done. It's being quick to forgive and understanding the necessity to embrace, to pull in, and to see people nurtured in the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then verses 23 through to the end of the chapter. I and them and you and me, I and them and you and me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also, whom you gave me, may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which you have given me,
for you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you, and these have known that you sent me. And I have declared to them your name and will declare it, that the love with which you loved me may be in them and I in them. And so lastly is the love of Christ in this place. The love of Christ. And the love of Christ, we understand, is an agape love. It's a sacrificial love. Again, it's a love that is given through grace. And so we have to understand, when people leave here, are they truly leaving having experienced the love of Christ? And to that end, have I done my part in that? Because, and I'll close with this, in 1 Corinthians, we're all well familiar with this, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul's speaking of spiritual gifting. He's speaking of what he has enabled people to do for the work of ministry. And sometimes we can lose focus and we can so easily get lost in what we're able to do. We're able to do it better than somebody else, able to do it effectively, whatever it is. But when you get caught up in what you're able to do, a lot of times you lose the love that you're to have in what you do. Because he says in chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, verse 31, but earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I show you a more excellent way. Then he goes into chapter 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. So he's saying, even though I've got the gift of tongues, if I don't have love, I'm just somebody who's irritating people by it. Instead of God being glorified and edified through the speaking of tongues, it becomes an irritant to the people in the body of Christ. And so I have to consider myself, am I exhibiting love, or has my spiritual gifting become an irritant within the body of Christ? Secondly, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains but have not love, I'm nothing. When he says I'm nothing, he means I'm of absolutely no use to God. Gift of prophecy, I may know the word of God back and forth. I may have greatest faith in the world, but if I don't have love, it's not going to achieve any benefit for God's glory. And then thirdly, takes it to an extreme, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. And so the idea is he's standing before God in heaven and said, everything that I have, I gave to the poor. Matter of fact, I sacrificed I was martyred for my faith. And God is basically telling us here through the Holy Spirit, you're going to stand before God and it's not going to be any profit whatsoever for you if you didn't do it in the spirit of love. How many people did you know that were just brilliant in the scriptures, even seemed to have this relationship with God, but there was just that disconnect because there was no love. There was no desire to see others come into that saving knowledge or really into that close relationship with Jesus Christ. Because what we have to understand that, yeah, we have the mind of Christ through the word of God, but do I have the hands of Christ? Do I have the arms of Christ that reach out and touch people as Christ did when he walked here? Am I able to offer that to somebody in such a way that it opens the door to the spiritual gifting that I have or the word of God that I know? Because again, you can know all these things and you can deliver it in such a way that people will want absolutely nothing to do with it. Or you can offer it in such a way that they want everything to do with it. That we truly represent Christ as we give love, as we season our gifting and the word of God with love, it opens the door. And so one thing, last thing that I want you to consider before you leave here today, our church, and if we fail in any one point, what's your part to shore it up? Let me know if you think we're falling short. But is our church glorifying God? Do we exist for the glory of God, or is it the glory of a people or a person? Is our church centered upon the Word of God? Not just that the Word of God goes out, but are we truly centered on the teaching, the learning, and the doing of the Word of God? Is there joy in this church? Is this church seeking after holiness and sanctification? Is this church reaching out? I think that's an area we can do better. Is this church unified? And is this church exhibiting love? It's that which we all need to come to the conclusion that we are doing these things, and each person in this room, this isn't just a pastor thing, each person in this room needs to consider what his part is in each of these elements of what a church is to be,
to shore these things up. Father, once again, we just thank you for your word that you have given us, Father, that glorifies your name. And I just pray, Father, that as we humbly come before you, seeking to glorify you, that your glory would be seen upon us. And so, Father, we just lift up this opportunity, especially this time of the year, Father, that, Lord, all of these things would be so valuable, especially when people come to church who rarely come to church, that, Father, as they come, they will leave this place once again, knowing that they have been with you. And so, Father, just fill us with your Spirit. Enable us in these things, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and stand, please. A couple of things. Out in the fellowship hall, Rosemary has meatballs waiting for you. And she's got a half-eaten birthday cake out there. So I don't know what's up with that, if it's leftovers or whatever. Or maybe it just tasted real good, and she took a few bites out of it on the way over. We're going to be having our movie night and Agape Feast this coming Sunday night, and there's sign-up sheets at the sign-up tables over there that if you could sign up for a side dish or whatever is listed there, that would be great if you're planning on coming. You don't have to, but that would be a help if you're able to. And then next week, starting on Monday, we're going to start our week of prayer and fasting. There is a form out there just to kind of give you some background on what that means and what's involved in all of that. Other than that, see you Sunday morning. God bless you guys.